Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Mary, seat of wisdom, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good, we are continuing where we left, making an appraisal of the efforts that happened in bringing about Christian unity. As you might be, you are aware that before the council, the popes called the separated brethren to return to the one fold of Christ. Instead, the Second Vatican Council invited the Christians to convert. The emphasis was to convert and come closer to Christ, hoping and believing that this closeness to Christ will make us one day one. It is a very good move. However, as things stand, we need to reconsider whether we should avoid completely the call of return, call to return. Let us look at some of the relationships that we have. For instance, in our relationship with the Orthodox and the Oriental churches, though closest to the Catholic Church in terms of faith, sacraments, and apostolic authority, many emotional and political factors block any form of reunion in the immediate future. A section of the Greeks consider any form of reconciliation with the Catholic Church a betrayal of the ancient faith and calls it the pan-heresy of ecumenism. The Russian Orthodox Church, which is the largest of those churches, has been adamant in rejecting any claim to papal authority and primacy. The Pope, that is Pope Francis, was able to personally meet with the Patriarch of Russia, Cyril, recently, but that too had to be done in a foreign airport of Havana, Cuba, where they signed a very vague joint statement from the point of view of ecclesial unity. Now, when we look at the Communitas Reformation, though dialogues have been going on and a lot of goodwill is expressed, the many progressive decisions in these individual churches make an eventual union almost impossible. Many Protestant communities are opposed to Catholic Church because they perceive the Catholic Church to be reactionary, authoritarian, homophobic, misogynistic, and patriarchal. As a result, anti-Rome feelings among some Protestants is still quite high, though some of them seem to like Pope Francis. Given this situation of an impasse, and taking into consideration a significant number of Anglicans who wanted to be united with the Catholic Church, without, however, giving up their specific Anglican tradition, Pope Benedict XVI created the Anglican Ordinariate with the Apostolic Constitution Anglicanorum Certibus of 2009. This paved the way for some Christians of the Anglican Communion to be united with the Catholic Church in the unity of faith, sacraments, and apostolic leadership, while retaining many of their practices of spirituality and organizational structure. This was in fact the Vatican II's vision of a reconciled diversity with regard to the communities of the Reformation. Now, while Anglicanorum Certibus was godsend for many good Catholics who wanted to be fully united with the Catholic Church, those who joined the Ordinariate are still a minority and limited to a few countries. In Kenya and most English-speaking Africa, Anglicanorum Certibus had hardly any impact, simply because most of the Anglicans in these countries are closest to the Protestant style and theology than to the Catholic one. Similarly, there are no significant number of Christians in most of the communities of Reformation and later formed evangelical communities who wish to be united with Roman Church. So what do we do with a few who still cherish in their hearts the desire to be united? Do we leave them there? We confess and believe that the Catholic Church has a fullness of means of salvation. Lumen Gentium 14 says that the church, the Catholic Church, now sojourning on earth as an exile, is necessary for salvation. And so whosoever, knowing that the Catholic Church was made necessary by Christ, would refuse to enter or to remain it, could not be saved. That is a doctrinal teaching. So what should we do? Does the goal of a reconciled diversity mean that we should not invite individual Christians to join the Catholic Church? That question. Many Catholics, including members of the hierarchy, prefer to leave these Christians there, saying that they will be saved within their communities. But is that an act of charity towards them, withholding some of the means of salvation that the Catholic Church rightly possesses? Is it a service to that truth, repeated also by the Second Vatican Council, that the Church sojourning now is necessary for salvation? So do we wish to keep them in their lack of access to the full deposit of faith, or do we invite them to belong fully to the Catholic Church? Or is it time to go back to the earlier call of come, return, join? Some have accused those who think that they should be invited through word and witness to belong to the Catholic Communion of proselytism. Unfortunately, in a test of 1993, the so-called Balamand document of the Orthodox Roman Catholic Joint Theological Commission, which met in Balamant, Lebanon, issued a document called Uniatism, Method of Union of the Past, Present, and for Full Communion. Uniatism is basically a call to return. It rejected Uniatism as a method of seeking unity today, while recognizing the existence of Eastern Catholic churches as part of the Catholic Church. Though it recognizes the existence of Eastern Catholic churches, however, the document does not give a solution to the current need of promoting visible unity of the churches on the one hand and the opposition of the major Orthodox churches to the Catholic Church. Do we give up the cause of truth for the sake of peaceful coexistence? Is it indeed a grave sin to receive Orthodox Christians into the Catholic Communion, especially into the Eastern Catholic churches? It seems to me that the current situation the Balamant document will not serve the cause of Christian unity, because as long as the hierarchy or the Orthodox and Orientals keep rejecting the divinely willed role of papacy at the service of unity and rejecting the dogmas of faith developed in the second millennium, there is no way forward for those who are moved in their conscience to be fully united with the Catholic Church while living their ancient traditions to be united. Uniate churches are spaces for such people. And why should the uniate churches and the invitation to belong to such churches be rejected? So that is a real question. From all that has been said so far, I think it is evident that there exists within some of the Catholic hierarchy and ecumenists a form of ecumenism that actually does more harm than good, or a false ecumenism about which Pope Pius XI had said. Now, what is then genuine ecumenism? The genuine ecumenism which the Second Vatican Council intended does exist, though often in small groups and expressions. It exists among those Christians who ardently desire in their hearts that the Christian family be united as the one church that Jesus founded. These Christians are united not only by shared Christian belief, but also by a common hope that Christ's truth might once again unify their deeply divided church. Community of Teze, which image you see, and Brother Roger Schulz, who began that in 1949 and which has now spread to many parts of the world, is a good example of this. Without denying the underlying serious doctrinal difficulties to communion, this unique monastic community became a center where Protestants, Catholics, and Orthodox monks could come together in prayer, reflection, and service, not at the expense of truth, but as an expression of their longing for unity and the need for the grace of God. Since that time, Taizé in France has become a place of pilgrimage and common prayer for countless thousands of Christians from various traditions, especially for the youth, showing how the young generation longs for and wants unity. True ecumenism exists in the hearts and lives of Christians who are seekers of truth and promoters of charity. Signs of fruitful ecumenical activities abound among Catholics. Without belittling the foundation of their Catholic faith, they relate to their neighborhood, come to the aid of those in difficulty and need assistance, engage in activities that promote the common good, and will invite those who are drawn to the Catholic faith and life to do so by becoming full members of the Catholic Church. Many evangelical churches seem to recognize the Catholic Church as a defender of the natural law-based morality, for instance. Such Christians share a common core of Christian belief about God, His only begotten Son, and the intrinsic value of Christian human life, as well as a commitment to defend these truths. They are also profoundly aware of the vital importance of standing as one, united in prayer, armed with the Word of God and guided by the Holy Spirit into the way of peace. More Christians now understand the responsibility of all believers for bringing faith in Jesus Christ and Him crucified to a world thirsting for peace and joy that only true faith can bring. You see them in the controversies and difficulties of the giants of contraceptive mentality and abortionists who try to spread their ideology all around. And it is there that we often notice the good evangelical Christians and Catholics coming together in defense of human life and a morality based on natural law. These are visible in many countries. There is solid ground for hope in such alignments on an ecumenism of charity and working together for the common good. And in God's time, God will bring their hearts together, and there would be unity in faith, in sacraments, and in judicial government. And that is our hope and prayer. We shall, in the next section, the fourth section, come, we shall look at the years ahead. What must we underline in the years ahead? And that would be the next broadcast. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. In the name of the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.